Welcome students of Thakur Vidya Mandir High School and Junior College. Students, we are going to go through the chapter 9, that is Current Electricity Part 1. In this chapter, students, we are going to study about the complicated circuit. A circuit containing several complication connections of electrical components cannot be easily reduced into a single loop of series or parallel combination of resistors. Therefore, a scientist named Gustav Robert Kirchhoff formulated the two rules for analyzing a complicated circuit. Now, Kirchhoff's law for electrical network could be studied with the help of this diagram. This is an electrical network which is showing you a steady current flow through the network of resistors. You could see are the resistors 1, 2 and 3 in the diagram. As follows, what you could see is two circuits connected together and giving you the formation of a loop. Let us understand the concepts. First concept is junction. Any point in an electrical circuit where two or more conductors are joined to two or more another conductors are going to be called as a junction. A loop, that is any closed conducting path in an electric network, is called as a loop or a mesh. Branch. A branch is any part of the network that lies between the two junctions. So we could say that the two junctions are labeled as A and B in the diagram. There are three branches that are possible. Paths are 1, 2 and 3, which you could clearly see in the diagram on the left hand side showing the electric network. Let us move on to the Kirchhoff's first law. Now I show you a diagram out here, and this diagram is showing you certain currents which are flowing inwards and certain currents which are flowing outwards. The algebraic sum of the current at a junction is zero in an electrical network. So let me consider a junction P in a circuit where the six conductors meet. Therefore, we can write that I1 minus I2 plus I3 plus I4 minus I5 minus I6 is equal to 0. Now, you all might be thinking that how we take this currents as positive and how we take this currents as negative. So, the current, that is I1, I3 and I4, which are moving inwards, are positive currents. Whereas the leaving currents, that is I2, I5 and I6, are considered as negative. Thus, the total current flowing towards the junction is equal to the total current flowing away from the junction. So, from the first equation, when I take all the negative values on the other side of the equation, I get a combination where you will be seeing that flowing current is equal to the sum of the leaving currents. Let us move to the next concept, that is the Kirchhoff's voltage law. As this law states that the algebraic sum of the potential differences and the electromotive forces in a closed loop is zero. That is, the summation of IR plus the summation of E, that is electromotive force, is giving you nothing but zero. Let us understand the sign conventions when you go through the electrical network which is set out here. Students, you could see two different loops which are present out here. The first loop, namely, is A, B, F, G, A, which is towards the left hand side. And the second loop is B, F, D, C, B, which is towards the right hand side. So let me explain you the concepts, which values you are going to consider positive and which values you are going to consider negative. While tracing a loop through the resistor, if you are traveling along the direction of conventional current, the potential difference is considered to be negative and vice versa. The EMF of an electric source is positive while tracing the loop within the source from the negative terminal of the source to its positive terminal. Therefore, applying the sign conventions, that is minus IR I1 R1 minus of I3 R5 minus I1 R3 plus the EMF is equal to zero. If I consider the first loop, that is A, B, F, G, A. So when I try to write down my E1, that is the electromotive force along E1. I'll take all the negative values on the other side of the equation and I write that as I1 R1 plus I3 R5 plus I1 R3 is going to give me electromotive force, which is E1 as positive. If I consider the loop, that is B, F, D, C, B in anti-clockwise direction, I again write that minus I2 R2 minus I3 R5 minus I2 R4 plus E is equal to 0. This E is E2, that is the EMF2. So when I try to write down the value of EMF2, I write it as I2 R2 plus I3 R5 plus I2 R4. Thus the sign conventions along the circuit gives us the values according to what? According to the Kirchhoff's law. Choose some directions of the currents. Reduce the number of the values using the Kirchhoff's first law. Determine the number of the independent loops. Apply the voltage law to all the independent loops. Solve the equations obtained simultaneously, and in case the answer of a current variable is negative, the conventional current is flowing in the direction opposite to that chosen by us. These are the steps usually followed while solving a problem using the Kirchhoff's law. We now come across the instrument which is able to measure out this different electrical laws and the loops. Let us understand about the Wheatstone bridge. Resistance of a material changes due to the several factors such as temperature, strain, humidity, displacement, liquid level, etc. Wheatstone's bridge is generally used to measure the resistances in the range from the 10 of ohm to the 100 of ohms. It was originally developed by Charles Wheatstone to measure the values of the unknown resistances. Students, let us understand what do you see in this diagram. I again mention out towards the left hand side, the loop which is formed is ABDA, which I am going to read as in a clockwise direction. Then I read the second loop towards the right hand side as BCDB. So this is the loop which is being formed. The respective currents that is flowing from the point A is I1, I2. When I talk about the current which is flowing across B and D is going to be a difference of I1 minus I2, and another one is going to be across D is I2 plus I3, and finally we move on to the current that is through the galvanometer, which is given as I4. So let us talk about the different currents and the loops based on the Kirchhoff's law. We will try to understand the derivation part, how to find out the balancing condition in a Wheatstone bridge. The four resistances, that is P, Q, R and S, are connected to form a quadrilateral A, B, C and D, where the galvanometer of internal resistance capital G is connected between the points B and D, as you have seen in the diagram which I have shown you right now. When the key is closed, the current I flows through the circuit. It divides into I1 and I2 at the point A. I1 is the current through the point P and I2 is the current through the point S. Therefore, the current flowing through the point Q and R respectively is given as I1 minus IG and I1 plus IG, where I is equal to I1 plus I2. So, applying the Kirchhoff's law in the loop, that is ABDA clockwise, I get minus I1P minus I1G plus I2S is equal to 0. Now I again consider the loop towards the right hand side, that is BCDB clockwise. I get a negative of I1 minus IGQ plus I2 plus IGR plus IGG, which is flowing across the galvanometer, giving me 0. Therefore, from both the equations 1 and 2, that is through the points Q and R and the points P and S, we get the total value as minus I1P plus I2S is equal to 0 and minus I1Q plus I2R is equal to 0. So when I divide this equation 4 and 5, I get the values as P upon Q is equal to s upon r, and this gives us the condition for balancing the Wheatstone bridge. After the Wheatstone bridge, students, let us move to the another concept, which is meter bridge. Now, meter bridge is a scale which consists of 1 meter in length, stretched on a meter scale, fixed on a wooden table, as you could see in the diagram over here. The ends of the wire are fixed below the 2 L-shaped metallic plates, which is seen very clearly in the diagram. A single metallic strip separates the 2 L-shaped strips, leaving the 2 gaps, and those gaps are left gap and a right gap. Usually, a known resistance is placed in the right gap and an unknown resistance is placed in the left gap. There is a jockey J which is connected to the galvanometer, while the other terminal is attached to the central strip. The temporary contact of the wire AB can be established with the help of the jockey. So this is what all our diagram says about the functioning of a meter bridge. Let us move on to the constructional part. The constructional part, I could say again, is a meter bridge consisting of a uniform cross section, 1 meter wire in length placed on a meter scale which is fixed on a wooden scale. Temporary contact with the wire AB can be established with the help of the jockey. A cell of EMFE along with a key and a rheostat are connected between the points A and B. Please go through the points given in the textbook thoroughly. We now move on to the working of a meter bridge. A suitable resistance is selected from the resistance box. The jockey is brought in contact with the AB at various points on the wire, and the balance, that is the null point, is D, is obtained. The galvanometer shows no deflection when the jockey is at the balance point. Let the respective lengths between A and D and that between D and C be Lx and Lr. So using the balanced condition, x upon r is equal to r of AD divided by r of DB. If small l is the length of the wire and rho is its specific resistance and capital A is the cross section, then x upon r is equal to r of AD divided by r of DB is given by Lx upon Lr. Therefore, the unknown resistance is Lx upon Lr multiplied by capital R. So, knowing the values of R, Lx and Lr, the value of the unknown resistance can be determined. The last concept of this part 1 is Calvin's method to determine the resistance of a galvanometer G by using a meter bridge. Students, when you see the diagram, you could see the difference that the galvanometer is being shifted from the central strip to the left hand side, and you could see that the Lx is now written as Lg, whereas your known resistance is again towards the right hand side only, and that gap is written with the length as Lr. This particular method is called as Calvin's method. The galvanometer whose resistance G is to be determined is connected in one of the gaps where I had usually kept the unknown resistance in the earlier diagram of the meter bridge. Now you could see that this is being replaced. Let us understand the working of a meter bridge using the Calvin's method. Now, suitable resistance is taken in the resistance box. The current is sent around the circuit by closing the key without touching the jockey at any point of the wire, the deflection in the galvanometer. The rheostat is so adjusted to get a suitable deflection around 2/3 of the range. Now, the jockey is tapped at different points of the wire and a point of contact D for which the galvanometer shows no change in the deflection is found. As the galvanometer shows the same deflection with or without the contact between the points B and D, these two points must be equipotential points. So let Lg be the length of the segment of the wire opposite to the galvanometer and Lr be the length of the segment opposite to the resistances. Let us understand how we are going to obtain the formula for finding out the resistance of the galvanometer. Now, I use the calculation part. let RAD, that is the resistance across AD, and the resistance across DC be the resistance of the two parts of the wire AD and DC respectively. Since the bridge is balanced, I would be getting G upon R is equal to resistance AD divided by resistance DC. Now, resistance AD upon resistance DC is as good as LG upon LR. That is the length across the galvanometer, the length across the known resistance. So, when I write this, the length across the known resistance, it becomes 100 minus of LG. Since we know that LG plus LR is equal to 100. Therefore, when I try to write down the formula for knowing the resistance of the galvanometer, it is written as LG divided by 100 minus LG multiplied by R. So, students, we cover up all the topics related to your meter bridge, Wheatstone meter bridge, and the meter bridge using Kelvin's method. Now, let us understand the assignment questions. Are Kirchhoff's law applicable for both AC and DC currents? In Wheatstone's meter bridge experiment, the null point is obtained in middle one-third portion of the wire. Why is it recommended? State any two sources of the errors in meter bridge experiment and explain how they can be minimized. For reference, e-textbooks, go through the link which is mentioned out here. Please go through the diagrams thoroughly, try to understand the concepts. This could be explained well when we meet back in the physics laboratory with the concepts being actually used in practicals. Thank you, students.